A very good evening to all. My name is Abhishek, and now I would it's really our pleasure to welcome everyone for this national webinar on multiple myeloma. And we are thankful to Agrawal sir for helping us do it through MHG Group. And I think I just wanted to share that apart from the kind of portfolio we have in multiple myeloma, including Kyprolis, which is original carfilzomib. We are happy to share that we had initiated work for the BCMA CAR-T, which is for the myeloma. And we are expecting that if the things go on well, by 24, we should have this BCMA CAR-T for the Indian patients. I think with this, I would know it is really great to have wonderful faculties, including Dr. Mama Chandy sir, with us today. And I would request and now hand it over to Dr. Agrawal sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Abhishek. So, good evening to one and all. Today's webinar is on multiple myeloma managing in 2021. This webinar is brought to you by Mumbai Hematology Group. It is supported by Dr. Reddy's, manufacturer of Kyprolis, the original brand of carfilzomib, bortezomib by name Myzome, lenalidomide by name Linenjo, pomalidomide by name Pomirate. This is managed by Mice Ideas. They have been always helping all our webinars. I thank Mr. Abhishek Bhavsar and the team from Dr. Reddy's, Mr. Rajesh Kalpesh and the team from Mice Ideas, the Executive Committee of Mumbai Hematology Group, our chief guest today, Dr. Maman Chandy from Calcutta, Dr. Sharad Damodar, moderator of the panel discussion, and the panelists who are themselves eminent hematologists or medical oncologists. And of course, all of you participants for sparing your Friday evening. We will begin with a lecture on newly diagnosed multiple myeloma. How do we change our practice based on FORTE trial? An update from ASCO 2021. This lecture will be given by myself. This will be followed by a panel discussion on relapse refractory myeloma, how do I manage in India? Moderated by Dr. Sharad Damodar, his clinical director, MSMC, senior consultant hematologist, head of hematology and bone marrow transplant at Majumdar Shah Medical Center, Narayan Health City, Bangalore. The panelists this evening include Dr. Hari Menon, hemato-oncologist, medical oncologist, BMT physician, at Cytocare Cancer Hospital, Bangalore. Dr. Dinesh Burani, Director, Department of Hemato-Oncology Bone Marrow Transplantation at Rajiv Gandhi Cancer Institute and Research Center, New Delhi. Dr. Rahul Naithani, Director, Hematology and Bone Marrow Transplant, Max Super Speciality Hospital, Saket, Delhi. Dr. Akanksha Garg, Assistant Professor, Hematology and BMT, Department of Medical Oncology, GCRI, Ahmedabad. Dr. Kishore Kumar S., hemato-oncologist, BMT physician, Miot International Hospital, Chennai. Dr. Tufan Dolai, professor and head hematology department, NRS Medical College Hospital, Kolkata. Dr. Neeraj Siddharthan, clinical professor and HOD, Department of Clinical Hematology at Amrita Institute of Medical Sciences, Kochi. And Dr. Upendra Sharma, consultant hematologist and hemato-oncologist at Bhagwan Mahavir Cancer Hospital Research Center, Jaipur. So those are our panelists for this evening. And now to introduce our chief guest, Dr. Maman Chandy. He doesn't require an introduction. This is just to complete the formalities. He's director, Tata Medical Center, Kolkata. After his post-graduation in medicine, 4 decades ago, that is 1978, from CMC Willow, he specialized in hematology from Sydney, Australia in 1985. He's fellow of Royal Australasian College of Physicians and fellow of Royal College of Pathologists of Australasia. Subsequently, He was professor, Department of Hematology at CMC Willow until 2010, when he retired and became director of Tata Medical Center, Kolkata. He is in that position until today. During his tenure in CMC Willow, he was head department of hematology for 20 years, that is 1987 to 2007. He was also associate director, HRD, CMC Hospital Vellore from 2000 to 2004. He was instrumental in developing the best department of hematology at CMC Vellore, followed by equally good department of hemato-oncology at TMC Kolkata. He was instrumental in developing various branches of hematology in his department at CMC Vellore, including bone marrow transplantation, molecular hematology, coagulation and thrombosis lab, etc. His was the first department to be recognized for DM in hematology. He has been the chairman for Task Force on Human Genetics and Genome Analysis, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India. Member, Scientific Advisory Committee, Basic Medical Science Division, ICMR. Member, Scientific Advisory Committee, National Institute of Human Hematology, Mumbai. Member, Scientific Advisory Committee, Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. Under his guidance, many research projects have been executed. Few of these include evaluation of the National Nutritional Anemia Prophylaxis Program by ICMR 1984, field supplementation trial by ICMR 1984, collaborative study on hemophilia ICMR 1985, evaluation of immunosuppression with anti-T-cell monoclonal antibody in the treatment of severe aplastic anemia, ICMR 1987, molecular genetics of thalassemia, hereditary bleeding disorders and leukemia, Department of Biotechnology, 2004. Well, with this little introduction, it's my pleasure to invite Sir to inaugurate this webinar and also speak a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Agarwal, for that very generous introduction. And I would like to congratulate you for the way in which you have contributed to hematology education throughout India. I don't know where you find the energy and the ability to put together the many talks that you gave, and also the organization of so many webinars that bring to India the latest in the field of hematology. So with your permission, I would like to just say a few words of introduction to this topic, and therefore I would like to share my screen with you. And the topic that is going to be discussed by Dr. Agarwal today is a topic which is of great interest and where the field has been moving in leaps and bounds. The first thing I want to say is that patients with myeloma today live long. And some of them live as long as 10 years. And over these 10 years, they have received multiple types of treatment. And unless this is documented properly, your patient who may seek a consult from somebody else, that somebody else will have to struggle to come to grips with what has happened over the last many years with this patient. So my plea to everyone is that you must have a sheet. And this is the progress sheet that we use at TMC. And I can assure you that if you faithfully enter this data, for us now it is online, so that data from our HMS will be dumped onto this, it will allow an individual within a few minutes to come to grips with a patient who has had multiple lines of treatment and where he is today. So my first plea to everybody who treats myeloma, please document document serially and faithfully. This will make life easy for the patient and for anybody else who has to treat that patient when you are not there. The second point I'd just like to make is that imaging has really changed dramatically. And I want to give you a small snapshot of what we're doing at TMC in Kolkata. This is our latest MRI machine. And these are the coils which we put on when we want a whole body myeloma screen to be done. And this software is not yet available. It is still being evaluated. And you can see how beautifully the areas involved by myeloma are delineated. In this particular patient, when he started out, virtually his whole skeleton is full of myeloma, as depicted in the orange. After treatment, you can see how the disease has responded. And I can't show you the last set here, but at relapse, again, the orange comes up. So imaging can be very graphic and can really help you to get a handle on the disease. The last point I want to make is about treatment. This is the 1969 paper by Raymond Alexanian, where he shows how the addition of steroid to melphalan has made a difference in the progression-free survival. We have come a long way since then. And this cartoon in a review article in Hematologica shows how we have moved down the pathway. And all of you are familiar with the amount of biology of the environment in which the myeloma cell lives, the myeloma cell itself, and its lineage and clonal dependencies, and the plethora of agents that have been developed right down to CAR T cells to improve the survival. And today we have patients living many, many years down with multiple lines of treatment with very good quality of life. So myeloma has certainly come a long way. However, we must remember these three populations. Samir, who's a farmer, when he comes with myeloma, you have to approach him differently. This is him. And this is Mr. Bhattacharya, who is middle income. He's approached differently. And this is him and the sort of home he would come from. And this is Mr. Sengupta, who represents 2.5% of our population, where you can do anything you want for him, even send him to the US for CAR T cells if he has reached that stage. We must remember these profiles and suitably adapt our management strategy based on the resource base which we have. With these few words, I will hand you over to the maestro, Dr. Agarwal, who will take you through to 2021, what can be done for myeloma. Thank you, Dr. Agarwal.
Thank you, sir. You are a master. In 5 minutes, you conveyed what probably people take years to convey. Thank you very much for those words and those three profiles. Wonderful. I'll begin with the lecture now. So today we are discussing multiple myeloma managing in 2021. My job this evening is to discuss newly diagnosed multiple myeloma, and Dr. Sharad, my friend, will then take over about the relapsed setting. I'm going to begin with some quiz questions, and there are going to be 7 of them to begin with, and there are going to be another 5 at the end of my lecture. So you will have a few seconds to think of the answer that you want to give, and there is no correct or no wrong answer. You are free to choose whatever you want. The first quiz is, in what percentage of newly diagnosed multiple myeloma patients do you use Kyprolis, that is carfilzomib, upfront? That means you diagnose a case and your protocol includes carfilzomib. Never? 10 to 20% of patients, 20 to 30% of patients, 30 to 50% of patients, or over half of the patients? Your time starts now. So we have 75% of people would never start with carfilzomib irrespective of the patient profile. There are about 17.8% who will give it to about 10 to 20% of patients. So that is the answer to the first question. We go to the second question, and that is, what deters you from using Kyprolis upfront in a newly diagnosed myeloma patient? A, it is not more efficacious than bortezomib. B, it has more adverse reactions than bortezomib. C, the administration is not patient friendly. D, it is more expensive. And E, I will like to save it for the second line. Your time starts now. Right, so we have reasonable division. 38 or 36.8% of us will like to save it for the second line. 34% don't use it because they find it is expensive. All right, we'll go to the third question. When do you use Kyprolis upfront in a newly diagnosed multiple myeloma? So some fraction of you were using it. So when do you use it? A, in patients where bortezomib is contraindicated, maybe due to peripheral neuropathy or any other reason. B, patients who cannot tolerate bortezomib, getting severe diarrhea or some other complication. C, these are patients who have high-risk myeloma. D, patients who desire the most effective treatment and to whom cost is irrelevant. Profile 3 of Dr. Maman Chandy. And last, all newly diagnosed multiple myeloma patients, unless there is a medical contraindication. Your time starts now. All right, so we have again one third of the people, when they use this drug, they are using it because bortezomib is contraindicated. 28% of you use it for high-risk myeloma. 23% of you use it because cost was immaterial to the patient. Thank you. We go to the next. What is your most fearsome toxicity of Kyprolis? Cardiac toxicity, nephrotoxicity, infusion reaction, peripheral neuropathy, or all of above? Please vote. Right? So 60% of you are considering cardiac toxicity as the most fearsome, while 30% feel that all of the above are relevant. I must mention here that infusion reactions and peripheral neuropathy with carfilzomib is negligible. Nephrotoxicity occurs, but it is just little next to negligible. Next one, please. So what's the dose of Kyprolis that you use? 27 milligram per meter square on 2 consecutive days per week for 3 weeks. 56 milligram per meter square once a week for 3 weeks. 70 milligram per meter square once a week for 3 weeks, or any other dose. Time starts now. So we have half of the people use it on two consecutive days every week. And I must say here that this is one particular protocol because of inconvenience has been given up worldwide. One third of the people have said that they will use 56 milligram per meter square once a week, and that appears to be the most appropriate answer because you invariably use it in combination with two more drugs. And 10% said that 70 milligram per meter square, that's the dose recommended when you use it only with steroid and there is no third drug. All right, we move to the next. The second last question is, what is your preferred partner for Kyprolis in NDMM? And I must tell you that steroid is not to be discussed. That is mandatory, as Dr. Mahaman showed how steroid started, but steroid is there all over. So we are talking about the third component: thalidomide, lenalidomide, cyclophosphamide, melphalan, or daratumumab. Your time starts now. So lenalidomide has been the option for 70% of you, and I would say yes, you are on the dot. And the last option now, last quiz. And do you use Kyprolis with lenalidomide in the maintenance phase? Okay, induction over, consolidation over, transplant over, you are in the maintenance phase. Do you add Carfil's Homeop to lenalidomide? Yes, always. No, never. Only for high-risk myeloma. Only for high-risk myeloma where bortezomib is contraindicated. Your time starts now. Okay, this is one third, one third, one third. So some one third have said no, never. One third have said only for high risk, and one third have said that we will use it for high risk only if bortezomib is contraindicated. So reasonably right, because standard of care is lenalidomide, but maintenance therapy is getting personalized. We will see that in my talk. So with that, the quiz session is over. I begin the part one of today's webinar, and so most of you must have heard of Forte trial, the Italian trial, which has been around for 7 years. This is one of the longest trial which has been on and on and on. It began in 2014. So yeah, almost 7 years. Newly diagnosed transplant eligible myeloma patients. And we are going to see what is the impact of this trial, which has gone on for 6-7 years, on our practice. And we will also cover that part of Forte trial that was presented for the first time in ASCO this year. So Forte trial, these are the authors of the publication or presentation rather in ASCO 2021. And it is Francesca Gay, the first author of this particular presentation. And she has been the last author of various presentations, a part of Forte. Subgroup analysis has been published repeatedly in various parts of this trial. Forte trial basically teaches you or educates you or tells you all about carfilzomib-based treatment in newly diagnosed transplant-eligible myeloma patient. This is the design of the study, and we will go over the design. Multicenter randomized open label phase 2. So you've got newly diagnosed myeloma patient eligible for transplant under the age of 65. Almost about little less than 500 patients, equally divided in 3 groups. Now, what are these 3 arms? So you have carfilzomib all over. You got lenalidomide in 2 arms and cyclophosphamide in 1 arm. Then after 4 cycles, stem cell mobilization, single transplant, which is done for 2 groups, that is KRD, KCD, and the 3rd group of KRD, there is no transplant. After that, you give four more cycles, same as induction, four more cycles of consolidation. And then there is a second randomization in which you give maintenance with lenalidomide versus maintenance with carfilzomib and lenalidomide. The flow for the day will be to see the impact in induction, the role of autologous transplant, maintenance therapy, and in high-risk myeloma. First, we'll talk about the induction. What's your induction for most of the patients newly diagnosed multiple myeloma who are transplant eligible? And your answer will be triplet VRD. Bortezomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone. Almost probably 99% of you do this today. Now, if you look at standard risk versus high-risk patients, then with VRD, high-risk patients do not do that well. Median progression-free survival, 76 months versus 40 months. Overall survival, once again, not reached in standard risk, but 78 months in the high risk. And if you add one more drug, for example, here, daratumumab has been added to VTD, your results immediately improve. But once again, when you come to the high risk profile, even Dara has not been able to take care of the high risk as well to bring it to the standard risk. Now, in our Forte trial this evening, these three arms, just to recapitulate, you had KRD with transplant, KCD with transplant, KRD without transplant, okay? Now, this is the first result. KRD versus KCD, both followed by transplant, KRD is superior to KCD. Now, peculiarly in India, half the consultants, and we did a voting on this to find that out, still use cyclophosphamide as the first line therapy, which should be considered obsolete. And these are invariably hematologists, oncologists trained in UK, because for long, long time, lenalidomide was not approved upfront and they had to use cyclophosphamide. So KRD is superior to KCD in induction. And this has applied to almost any protocol comparing len versus cyclophosphamide with any proteasome inhibitor. The second part is the role of autologous stem cell transplant. So this is KRD in both the arms. Here it is KRD with autologous transplant, here KRD 12 cycles. And KRD with transplant is superior to just keep giving KRD. So autologous transplant does not disappear even if you use KRD as your starting point. So that's with transplant, that's without transplant. The third part is the maintenance. Now, as I mentioned in the beginning, maintenance is getting individualized. So standard of care is immunomodulated drug. Thalidomide is popular only in developing countries because it is low cost, but it is toxic. While most of the developed world, and of course, including India, lenalidomide is the standard of care. It is less toxic and not expensive because of the generic. You must remember that in Western world where there is no generic len as yet, it is very expensive. Then you have got high-risk patients where standard of care has become bortezomib with, of course, lenalidomide. For ease of administration, it could be ixazomib with lenalidomide. And we will discuss today about carfilzomib. And then the last couple of years, you've got trials going on where monoclonals are used in maintenance phase. Daratumumab, to be more precise, the results have yet to come to show any advantage of that over these two, len and len plus PM. So len is the maintenance therapy. And if you look at the data of len maintenance without just observation, standard risk len is better than observation, high risk len is better than observation, ultra high risk len is better than observation. So it's essential to give len maintenance to everybody minimum. Then we come to len bortezomib as maintenance therapy, which is standard of care today for high risk myeloma patient. And what about carfilzomib as the maintenance? We will see as a part of Forte trial. The second randomization was KR versus R. And you look over here, this is len alone, and this is len with carfilzomib. All sorts of patients, this combination was superior to len alone. Same thing here. This is len with carfilzomib versus len alone. So Forte study looked at KR versus R alone as maintenance therapy. In standard risk patient, 3-year progression-free survival was 90% for the combination, 73% for len alone. And the best part is, even in high risk and double hit myeloma, similar difference was shown. This we will discuss when we come to the high risk. What should be the duration of maintenance therapy? It appears at the moment that the duration is endless till you get toxicity or a relapse of the disease. It's possible that the ongoing study may show you something different. Next step probably appears is to incorporate carfilzomib with the data that was shown to you over here in the maintenance therapy. And the last part is, who should get len alone and who should get carfilzomib with len? Overall, one thing is clear, that maintenance therapy is getting personalized. Len versus Velcade plus len versus Kyprolis plus len. We come to the fourth part, and that is high-risk myeloma. We will define high-risk myeloma. I want to specifically discuss about 1q copy number and its significance. We'll define what is double hit myeloma or ultra high risk myeloma, and then how does the treatment differ. So what is high risk myeloma? High risk myeloma is, as per the revised ISS, based on beta 2 microglobulin, albumin, LDH, and the most important, the high risk FISH. Deletion 17P, 414, and 1416. In addition, of course, 1Q copy number alterations, TP53 biallelic inactivation, number and size of lesions on the PET or MRI, patients having renal failure, frail patients, patients having circulating plasma cells, plasma cell leukemia, and extramedullary disease all account for high-risk myeloma, but except for 1Q copy number alteration, we'll not be discussing the rest. Gene expression profile is another way to pick up high-risk myeloma, but it's not available to you and me in clinical practice. The second part of my discussion is 1Q copy number significance. So 1Q copy number increment are present in 20% of MGUS patients, 40% of myeloma patients at diagnosis, and 70% of patients when they relapse. So this is one of the commonest genetic abnormality. And the gain of 1Q is associated with early progression of disease, even when you use your most popular VRD. And this shows you the impact of 1Q gain, how the progression-free survival decays. So gain of 1Q is common in newly diagnosed myeloma, present in 4 out of 10. It is not always associated with inferior outcome. For having inferior outcome, it should be 4 or more copies of 1Q. Or it should be associated with other high-risk cytogenetic abnormality like T414, 1416, or deletion 17P. That means it should be a double hit myeloma, or there should be 4 copies. Okay. Such patients have shorter progression-free survival, 25 months versus 34 months. Patients with 3 copies and those who are not associated with other high-risk cytogenetics do not impact the progression-free survival. So what's ultra-high-risk or double-hit or sometimes triple-hit myeloma? So you look at 3 parts, recurrent chromosomal translocations, then copy number aberrations like gain 1Q or deletion 17P. So 1, 2, and 3. If any 2 of these are present, it is double hit. If all 3 are present, then it is triple hit. So anything more than 2 abnormalities together will be called high risk or ultra high risk. So now coming to the last part, the treatment of this particular entity. Obviously, you have to be more intensive. What's the percentage of patients who have high risk or ultra high risk? 20 to 25%. That means every 5th or every 4th patient. So first is that you must do the FISH for every patient at diagnosis to pick up these 20-25% of patients. And then let's look at the FORTE data. So FORTE data in this ASCO looked at a subgroup analysis according to the cytogenetic risk status and impact of various arms. So you had patients with standard risk, high risk, and double hit. High risk in this was defined as more than one chromosomal abnormality, and if it was two or more, it was called double hit. So double hit actually becomes a part of high risk. Okay, remember that. So 60% are standard risk, or 70% are standard risk, 30% are high risk. Out of that, 10% may be double hit. So that is the three arms that we have been talking all through, and that shows you standard risk patients, high risk patients, and the double hit. And this double hit is incorporated in high risk, so it is 67-33, 61-39, 56-44. So everything was matching. You got 4-14, 14-16, deletion 17p, 1q gain, 1q amplification, and 1p deletion. Now, if you look at the results now, these are the risk of all three arms, standard risk. We are looking at after first randomization. That means we are not in the maintenance phase. A data of 51 months, more than 4 years. And you are looking at progression-free survival. So it is between 60 to 80% in the standard risk. In high risk, KRD with ASCT, it is 5 years. And in double hit, it is 4.5 years. So you can see the impact of using carfilzomib-based induction followed by transplant on high risk and double hit. The results may be a little bad when it is deletion 17p. It may be bad when it's amplification 1q. Otherwise, in the rest, it is nearly the same. The same thing over here. When in the second randomization where you gave maintenance with KR versus R. So obviously, KR is superior in the standard risk. It is superior in the high risk. It is superior in the double hit. And the most important part is that almost about, this is 3 year progression-free survival, almost about 65 to 70% of bad myelomas after 3 years progression-free survival. So that's achievement. Then you're looking at MRD, which is, there's no time to discuss that, but MRD has become the most fashionable part of myeloma. Even if you have a high risk disease and you become MRD negative, then it nullifies the effect of the high risk. So now what happens over here? All three arms, high risk, once there is K, you look at this, 47 to 62% MRD negativity before the maintenance, 39 to 50% in double hit. Sustained 1 year MRD negativity, high risk, anywhere from about 29 to 50%, and double hit, 17 to 47. So the arm that we prefer, KRD and ASCT. That is lenalidomide with Kyprolis followed by autologous transplant. Look at the data from high risk and double hit. 59%, 44%, 50%, 47%. So half or two-thirds of the patients are taken care of with respect to MRD negativity and sustained negativity for 1 year. So to conclude this part, this sub-analysis of 40 trial in patients of newly diagnosed myeloma according to the high risk feature suggests that KRD followed by ASCT significantly prolonged 4 year progression-free survival. And this happens in standard risk, high risk, and double hit. KRD ASCT also increased rate of 1 year sustained MRD negativity in high risk, double hit. Maintenance therapy significantly prolonged 3 year progression-free survival versus R alone in various cytogenetic groups. Standard, high risk, double hit. So benefits of KRD with ASCT followed by KR was observed in all cytogenetic group except amplification 1-3. So in conclusion, FORTE trial looked at the progression-free survival in transplant-eligible newly diagnosed myeloma patients treated with KRD induction followed by transplant and then KR maintenance in high-risk myeloma. 4 year PFS 62% in high-risk, 4 year PSF 55% in double hit, and with KR maintenance, 3 year progression-free survival 68% in both high risk and double hit. Conclusion is KRD followed by ASCT followed by KR maintenance helps high risk and double hit myeloma significantly. I come to the last part of my talk, and this talk is related to transplant unfit patient. I'll just take your 5 minutes. This is the study published in Hematologica just few days ago, 2021. Now here, as it is a European study, Len was not allowed upfront, so the study has cyclophosphamide. Despite that, so we are talking about carfilzomib, cyclophosphamide, dexamethasone in newly diagnosed high-risk patient not eligible for transplant, and it's a pool of two studies. Without wasting your time, I would say that age, sex, ISS, FISH, frailty score, and LDH, it matched in standard risk and high risk. And same thing about the responses, etc. We'll skip that. We'll come here. So progression-free survival. Standard risk, high risk. Now look at this particular protocol brings the high risk so close to the standard risk. And if you look at overall survival, the two curves just overlap. So the adverse effect of high risk is nullified when you are using Kyprolis-based triplet, even with cyclophosphamide. And that applies to deletion 17P. The two curves are overlapping. Conclusion, carfilzomib-based triplet induction followed by triplet consolidation with or without ASCT, depending upon your patient is fit or not, followed by maintenance with carfil and len, leads to superior progression-free survival, superior overall survival in all high-risk newly diagnosed patients, whether they are transplant fit or transplant unfit. So this protocol nullifies the traditionally poor prognosis associated with high risk when the patients are treated with bortezomib-based triplet. It is possible that DARA-based first-line therapy with or without carfil may also produce similar results, but that still remains to be documented. And a large segment of patients, at least in India, do not have an access to DARA because of its cost constraint. All newly diagnosed myeloma patients, therefore, must be subjected to FISH to pick up this 20% high risk. And if these are high risk patients, the treatment of choice will be carfilzomib-based triplet for induction. And I would say carfilzomib-len and dexa as the induction, intensification followed by carfilzomib-len, that means double drug and not Velcade, but carfilzomib-len-based maintenance should be considered as the standard of care. I come to the last part, that is my five more quizzes. Now let's see what the difference of impact it happens. So in what percentage of newly diagnosed myeloma patient will you use Kyprolis upfront? Never 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, more than 50. Please vote. Timer, please. Okay, so never has dropped to 3.7%. 10 to 20% 40, 20 to 30% 40. So between about, say about 80% of you will be using it in anywhere between 10 to 30. Okay, fine. So that's a change. What percent of newly diagnosed, what will deter you from using Kyprolis upfront in newly diagnosed? Options are same. We can go for voting. So we have expense still coming in the way of almost 60, two-thirds of the patients. Fine. Next one. When will you use Kyprolis upfront? Let's see now what impact is over here. When bortezomib is contraindicated, when bortezomib cannot be tolerated in high-risk myeloma patients, those who can afford anything on the earth, or where there is a medical contraindication. Oh, thank you for remaining awake. almost 80% say that you're going to use it for high-risk myeloma. Thank you so much for listening. Next one, credit of course goes to the workers who did the Forte trial. What will be your preferred partner? Thalidomide, lenalidomide, cyclophosphamide, melphalan, dara. Let's have preferably a single bar. So almost a single bar, 89%, not 100%, but 89%, 10% will still use cyclophosphamide. Interesting, very interesting. Next one, the last one, I think. Will you use Kyprolis with Len in the maintenance phase? Always, never, only for high risk, only for high risk where bortezomib is contraindicated. And I hope again there will be a single bar. Okay, so 70% will use it for the high risk, but there are 12% who will use it only if bortezomib is contraindicated. And interestingly, there are 15% who have totally changed over to carfilzomib for everybody. Wonderful. Great. But that may be a little overuse of carfilzomib. I think that was my last slide, isn't it? Is there any slide? No. Thank you so much for listening to me. You can close my slide sharing. There is a question lying in the question box. How to treat a patient with double-hit myeloma with TP53 mutation, T414, and amplification gain 1? So if the patient is transplant fit, it will be carfilzomib, len, dexa, followed by autologous transplant, followed by carfil, len, dexa intensification, followed by carfil, len maintenance. So that's it now, Damodar, all over. It's all yours now.
Thank you, sir. I'll just share my screen. Yeah, thank you. So now we'll go on to the second part of the webinar, which is practically patients in India. How do we manage patients with relapsed refractory myeloma in our country? And we've seen two of our stalwarts here give us the two introductory talks. Dr. Maman spoke about economic stratification, and Dr. Agarwal spoke about the risk stratification based on the disease status. And both have to be put into consideration when we need to manage a patient in India. So I'm glad to have a very elite list of panelists who've already been introduced. The list is here. I'll just read out their names again. We've got Dr. Hari Menon, Dr. Dinesh Purani, Dr. Rahul Naitani, Dr. Akanksha Gar, Dr. Kishore Kumar, Dr. Tufan Dolai, Dr. Neeraj Siddharthan, and Dr. Upendra Sharma. What we've done is given one case to each of them, which are actual cases worked up in India with whatever investigations done at that point in time, and asking them to discuss. We'll also be happy to get inputs from our two senior people, Dr. Maman Chandy and Dr. Agarwal, so that we get things put into perspective on how to manage this. So I will just briefly run through a few slides. This is a publication from Lancet Oncology as of March 2021, where this is from the International Myeloma Working Group, treatment recommendations for the treatment of relapsed refractory myeloma. And obviously this is the Western recommendation. So clearly recommendations are there. We need to look at its practical utility and how much we can put it to use in our own country. And that's the whole reason of doing this case discussion, so that we have data which is there, and then data which we can use and what we can put into practice. So clearly, like Dr. Agarwal mentioned, I think lenalidomide is the base treatment which is used in most patients. And so the recommendations also come on the back of that. So if you relapse, then the first definition becomes whether you're refractory to lenalidomide or you're not refractory. And based on that, you're recommended certain preferred options, which could be DRD or KRD here. You've heard the talk on the utility of carfilzomib. And then there are a host of alternatives, which again will depend on availability of drug, finances, patient comorbidity, general condition, etc. And then if you're refractory to lenalidomide, then you go the pomalidomide route or the DARA route with DKD, PVD, or even isatuximab, and look at options and various combinations. And then you also have alternatives which they've listed out coming from a recommendation perspective. So this is the first thing which you would want to do to find out whether your patient is refractory or not. Then if you look at some of the data which is actually there on the progression-free survival of patients who've been len refractory. This is in phase 3 trials for relapse of refractory myeloma. And you can see all the trials which are listed out here. I'm not going to really go into details on that. The Endeavor, Castor, the Optimism, Candor, ICEMA, and all of them clearly show the benefit of better progression-free survival when you have the three drug combinations versus the two. And some data here versus on VD versus KD as just two drug combinations. Again, the KD arm doing better from a progression-free median PFS. So this is what this particular slide highlights. Subsequently, when they've had any kind of previous line of therapy, if you look at all the combinations which have been tried out in these various trials listed here, here again, obviously the three drug is definitely better than the two drug when you look at the PFSs here. And then the addition of DARA showing some benefit in some of these. You also got elotuzumab and various other combinations in the various trials. Clearly, the three drugs outdoing the two drug combination. So I think that's the gist of this data. And subsequently, even when you go on to various other published trials, including data with selinexor and other combinations of isatuximab, clearly the combinations they're doing better when you give them as three drugs in combination with two drugs. So that's what is highlighted in these tables when they've actually put down numbers to the median PFS. Now, what happens when you go beyond two or more previous lines of therapy? So that's when all the newer drugs which we talk about, which may be very limited access. Again, there's a cost issue, but then there is data and that's what is there in the recommendation. So you've got the Eloquent trial talk about elotuzumab. You've got the Storm trial talking about selinexor. You've got the Dream trial talking about belantamab. And then you've got CAR T-cell therapy, which also was alluded to at the opening of this session, where we think it should be available in India in the next 1 or 2 years at all. I mean, if at all. And we will have a subset of patients who could possibly afford that and go on to that. And then once you go beyond second or higher relapse, obviously your options are becoming a little more limited and you're also going on to newer drugs, possibly combinations like DTPase, belantamab, elotuzumab, like what I've already mentioned, and the BCMA targeting CAR T cells. So on this background, I thought we'll now go on to the actual cases. And the first case is to Dr. Hari Menon. I'll just quickly run through the case briefly and then ask for his inputs and comments on how he would do anything different, and then subsequently when they relapse, what would be strategy to actually plan treatment for this patient. So this is a 56-year-old male who was diagnosed with multiple myeloma in December 2015 when he presented with a clavicle fracture. He was initially treated with VTD into 6 cycles and then underwent an autologous stem cell transplant in 2016, was on thal maintenance for a year. He also had some IBS issues which were mentioned there, reason for keeping him on thal for a little longer. Subsequently, was off medication when he developed easy fatigability and bone pains. A PET suggested the relapse of disease. He had multiple lytic lesions in the rib, vertebra, ileum, and the femur. This time, he was given Dara-Len-Dex in Jan 2020, and he took 12 doses of that. Then he was on Len maintenance from December 2020 when he developed pain in the left arm with a fracture humerus. Again, re-imaged features of disease progression. He was initially restarted on daratumumab for various reasons. Finishes 4 doses, and then subsequently in Feb 2021, he developed skin lesions, nodular lesions, and the biopsy was suggestive of a plasma cell neoplasm. Post that, he got Dara Carfilzomib weekly, had some issues with the side effects, and then was just put on pomalidomide maintenance and started getting progression of the skin lesion. So I'd like to invite Dr. Hari to give his comments on the approach here and also whether there are things which he would have done differently, and what would be his current thoughts on this particular case. Dr. Hari.
Thank you. Thank you, Sharad. A case that is probably what we commonly find in many a time in our clinical situation. One is the fact that the patient had probably around 3 years of disease-free survival over here before she had progression. And also the patient was progress while the patient was on thalidomide maintenance. So what I might have, it is right for us to re-challenge. We could have re-challenged again with carfilzomib over here, based on the VISTA study that has demonstrated a superior outcome for patients when we use carfilzomib in these patients. But alternatively, the choice of there is data for the use of monoclonal antibody too over here. But maybe I would have considered in this situation when the patient relapsed, maybe I would have considered a proteasome inhibitor here as against lenalidomide, because the fact that the patient had progressed while on an IMID in the form of thalidomide over there. So fair enough, but that was maybe that would have been one of the changes I would have considered over here. And the other aspect is that the patient did not have a great response with daratumumab, except for, I would say, a partial response, and the patient was continued on therapy. And we have a patient who's probably having a faster time to relapse after 2019 and probably had a third relapse within a span of 2 years. And it is also an extramedullary relapse over here. And the choice of treatment is are limited over here, except depending upon what we have to choose from. And we would, as is true over here, the next generation of treatment with pomalidomide is a reasonable option over here, and there is data to support that too. But again, he seems to be progressing over here. And under the circumstances, it becomes difficult to get a response in these patients. And one may even settle for some sort of a stable disease at this point of time. But if you do have other ways of treating these conditions, and if the skin lesion is probably loco-regional and is big, maybe we might consider some local treatment for that particular disease and continue with pomalidomide with the hope that it can be maintained with some degree of stability. And of course, we have the other lines of management that are evolving in treating such patients with myeloma. We might want to revisit the cytogenetic profile if there are some other modalities that might be used, like anything like using the 11-14 or translocation, wherein we might be able to exercise the option of venetoclax over there. Otherwise, we might want to consider, we might have to discuss the option of a cellular therapy in the form of a CAR T-cell therapy, if that is possible over here. But certainly, this patient is not going to have any sort of durable response at this point of time, given that the time to relapses and also the fact that the time to progression and the progression has been while on some form of a salvage therapy that is ongoing.
Thank you, Hari. Hari, with the progressing skin lesions, is there a need to kind of consider something more aggressive like a DD pace or, something else to bridge?
So yes, I would agree with you if the patient can agree, but those are only if we are thinking in terms of following it up with an allo transplant, if it is possible, because you might get a response in these patients because they are more aggressive, but the durability of the response is going to be quite limited. So if we are having a backup of or consideration for an allo transplant, then we might consider treating with consider a regimen such as DTPase. Of course, it's a tough regimen to go through with, but certainly you get responses, but I would say that the responses are not durable.
Right. Hari, any experience with some of the newer drugs, Hari, if you've used anything?
No, I haven't used any, but there is belantamab, which has been used there. I mean, you could use some of the other drugs like selinexor, which is over here. Elotuzumab can be tried. They're all permutations and combinations that can be considered over here, including even there's data for ixazomib over here to be tried in the relapse setting. With some degree of responses, but none of those responses are likely to be durable. And if you want to be realistic about getting some sort of a durable response, we certainly need to look at cellular therapy over here, which could either be in the form of an allo transplant after getting the patient into some reasonable control, or if there is an option of looking at CAR T-cell therapy, one might want to go through with it.
Right. Thanks, Hari. So any comments from Dr. Maman or Dr. Agarwal on this case, sir? Okay. I'll then go on to the next case. I put up some options here potentially, but I think we've gone through it. Hari did mention about possibly looking at the newer drugs and the fact that we could consider a DTPase, and if we could quickly get it into some kind of remission and then see whether we could top it up with an allo or a CAR T subsequent to that. Now, the next case is to Dr. Dinesh Burani. This is a 46-year-old male who presented with an IgA lambda myeloma diagnosed in November 2020. At that point in time, the marrow reports gave a percentage of 17% plasma cells, multiple lytic lesions. Karyotype was hypoploidy, and the FISH revealed a TP53 of 20%. Treated at another center where they gave him four cycles of KCD chemotherapy. The MRD was run and reported as 0.27%, and subsequently underwent an autologous stem cell transplant. At the third month review, he came in with bone pains, and the PET done at that point in time showed new lytic lesions. The marrow done at that point in time showed 65% plasma cells. There were a few plasma cells in the peripheral blood. It was still the IgA lambda subtype. So I'd like Dr. Dinesh's comments on this, on how he would have approached this patient and what he would kind of currently recommend as a treatment for this patient at this point in time.
He's 46, young. He has a T53, 20% with hypodiploid. He relapsed within 7 months. So four cycles of KCD and autologous transplant. And he has got a now plasma cell kind of a leukemia. So he's got a bad disease. So controlling it and taking for the allogeneic transplant would be the only option to save him considering he's young. He should be given a DARA. If possible financially. He's not been exposed to lenalidomide, so he should get a lenalidomide and probably some combination of DARA, LEN, and PACE. So he should be given an aggressive combination, probably including the chemotherapy along with the DARA, and if the LEN can be a part of it, followed by allogeneic transplantation. He's got a very aggressive disease. Right. And if carfilzomib he's exposed, so there's no there's no other thing. So he's not been exposed to LEN or POM and DARA and the chemotherapy combination, probably PACE.
Right. So Dinesh, initially this patient got KCD, and after Dr. Agarwal's talk, would you think you should have done something different like a KRD, or what are your thoughts on that initial management? And subsequently, I'll come to the question later.
He's high risk, so he should have got four drugs if possible. So rather than three drugs, whenever it's possible, should be given four drugs. Still, the VRD is one of the combinations. So even for the high risk.
Right.
So four drugs. If you're using a four drug, then DARA VRD.
Yeah, we just lost the last part of your thing.
Yeah, so if you're a three drug, probably KRD is okay. But if you're going for four drugs, the DARA VRD should be okay.
Right.
The trial, which was a KRD versus a VRD, even a high risk, there was no significant difference.
Right. So once you get him into remission, you will recommend an allo. So if he had a sibling, obviously sibling, in the absence of a sibling, would you still push for a haplo, Dinesh, and any particular protocol you would like to use?
Sharad, can I just interrupt here?
Yes, sir.
Dinesh, high-risk cases were not included in that study.
The high-risk was not...
not included, yeah.
In that study, but there is some data to suggest that KRD... So you can, if you're using a three-drug, probably this KRD, or if you want to use a DARA KRD or DARA VRD, if you see the Dr. Rajkumar and even Shaji's presentation, DARA VRD has been said to be a part of this. So I think the four drugs will be with the or KRD or VRD.
So upfront,
four you drugs, were talking about the transplant. The transplant, yeah, yeah. Even at going for haplo will be okay with him, considering it's a young age and very aggressive disease.
And is there any particular conditioning you would...
Post-transplant also you'll require a... Should include a melphalan. So if you're going for haplotransplant, probably flu-mel post-psi, and you can add a TBI or low dose and then go for a transplant.
Right. And any maintenance you would recommend, Dinesh, post-transplant then because he's so high risk?
Post-transplant, then you have to go on the maintenance. For 3 months, if there is no GVHD, you should consider for a...
Right.
So you need to be aggressive with his disease, unless you have a GVHD or something.
Right. Thank you, Dinesh. Is Dr. Maman there? So I'd like your thoughts on the transplant option here, sir. Is he there? Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for that. We'll move on to the third case for our discussion today. So this case is to Dr. Rahul Naitani. This is a 55-year-old lady who was evaluated for backache with tingling of both lower limbs, had grade 4 to 5 PAR in both lower limbs. PET showed multiple lytic lesions with mild cord compression, M-spike of 3.2 grams, marrow percentage of plasma cells 32%, kappa lambda ratio was 63 with a K of 657 and a lambda of 10.3. Again, this lady TP53 10%. She received local RT followed by VRD into 3 cycles. Subsequent to that, this was the response. M spike of 1.5 grams with a kappa lambda ratio of 13.4. So this is her current status. So, Dr. Rahul, I'd like your opinion on how you would have approached this patient. And at this point in time, what would you want to do from a treatment perspective? Would you want to change something and look at how you would want to manage this patient? Dr. Rahul.
So, yeah. So again, high-risk myeloma, not very bright response to the initial VRD, which was a very good upfront therapy to be used. And still the responses are, we are still in the kind of partial remission only. This remission is unlikely to continue longer duration. Now, the path ahead is basically two ways. One is, you know, change the therapy. Already exposed to bortezomib and lenalidomide, so change it to maybe daratumumab, carfilzomib, or daratumumab, pomalidomide, dexamethasone, something like that. Bring a deeper remission, go for autologous transplant. The other parallel path is also equally viable, where one could actually, she's, you know, received only 3 cycles so far. So 3 cycles is still lesser. But the other path, suppose it was 4 cycles or 6 cycles, the other parallel path is also acceptable there. One could, if one was able to mobilize enough stem cells, do an autologous transplant and then again, you know, consolidate it with an alternative therapy.
Right. So Rahul, if she was not TP53, in the absence of that, would you have done anything different or post-auto, what was your plan on the consolidation cycle, which you would then recommend in the absence of TP53, if you didn't have that risk?
So if my responses were adequate, if I was satisfied with my responses, VGPR or CR pre-transplant, have done a transplant and MRD was good, we do MRD at our center, then, you know, even lenalidomide maintenance alone should have been sufficient for this patient.
Okay. And you are routinely doing MRD. So at what time points are you assessing that, Rahul?
We are doing it at day 100 of transplant. I mean, sometimes between day 90 to 100, depending upon patient's travel plan. Usually okay. We aim at day 100.
And also pre-transplant or is it only post?
So we are doing one pre-transplant at the end of induction, but irrespective of the number, we still proceed with autologous transplant. And then day 100, we do a transplant. This is where we kind of, for people who are MRD positive, we are giving 2 cycles of consolidation and then followed by maintenance. We also counsel them for a bortezomib maintenance every 2 weekly if the MRD is higher, but lenalidomide maintenance is acceptable.
Okay, so you're using MRD to take that decision on the consolidation post-auto.
Yeah, so to upgrade, but not to downgrade.
Right. So otherwise, they would just go on to maintenance post that.
Yeah, that's correct.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Rahul. We will now go on to the next case, which is...
Sharad, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
TP 53%.
Yeah.
Your cutoff for significant versus non-significant. And biallelic versus monoallelic. And third was the question to Rahul. When do you use two drug maintenance? In which patient profile?
Sharad, you want to go first?
Go ahead, Rahul.
Go ahead, Rahul.
Yeah. So generally, again, we will look at high-risk myeloma. And the high-risk myeloma is one as per the standard definitions we have at diagnosis. We do FISH and all. We generally do not get information on TP53 on the biallelic or monoallelic. So actually, any TP53, we generally take it as significant. We do counsel them for tandem autologous transplant if they were 17p there. But the three patients that we counseled and they agreed for tandem auto because of the high risk, we were not able to mobilize enough stem cells for them. So they all ended up being, having single auto. None of our 17p deletion patient is a long-term survivor. I don't think anyone has survived beyond 3 years, any of the 17p patients. But anyway, so tandem autologous transplant, even though we clear our intent that we might go that way, we have not been able to do that. We also use one more criteria that we just discussed. So any high-risk multiple myeloma, we generally talk about bortezomib once every 2 weeks kind of maintenance. Again, for at our center's preference, if somebody was MRD positive, there also we counsel them for, there we give two cycles of consolidation and then we go for maintenance. And when we define high-risk myeloma, we are giving two cycles of consolidation, then bortezomib every 2 weeks is our preferred maintenance choice.
Borte plus len or only borte?
Generally, it's only bortezomib.
All right.
So, yeah, just to continue on Dr. Agarwal's questions, I don't know. So this percentage which we're getting, I think in some instances it comes up. Now, whether you will use 10% as the cutoff, or will you say that 20% is what is significant? There are some people who looked at up to 10% sensitivity to even define it, and thereby actually put that cutoff of 10% in this particular case, or whether you would just worry straight away and then treat this like a high risk. I mean, clinically, she's behaving like that in this particular case. And clearly, as you mentioned in your risk factors for high risk, the biallelic is what is put down there. But I don't know whether all of us are getting that kind of information whenever we are asking. It depends, I think, on the labs which are reporting it. So your thoughts on that, sir?
Yeah, MedGenome is the only lab I thought was giving so far. There may be other labs, but MedGenome is giving it. And I am delighted by one answer from Rahul that MRD positivity is leading to an aggressive maintenance. So I think that is probably the way to go in future. And one last thing is Dr. Anil Kumar Yadav, you put up a question and Dr. Damodar has answered that question. Okay.
Fine. Right. So we'll go on to our fourth case. This is directed to Dr. Akanksha Garg. This is a case of lambda light chain disease diagnosed in Jan 2018, a 52-year-old lady, RIS stage 3. These were the numbers when she was diagnosed, lambda of 5,000 odd with a bone marrow of 35% plasma cells. She was treated with 6 cycles of VTD and she relapsed in 2018. She didn't have a transplant at that point in time. Started on KPD, received 4 cycles. And she also got 30 gray radiation to a lower back lesion when she presented with that back pain. In PR, she underwent an autologous transplant on 29-3-2019. And that time, during part of that evaluation, when she relapsed, the cytogenetics data was as follows, which is written here. She was then given maintenance after SCT with the pomalidomide. Then she presented with pain on the left side of the face and then underwent imaging. MRI showed a well-defined enhancing lesion in the left Meckel scale, extending into the left intertemporal fossa, temporal fossa with along the trigeminal nerve, defined as a myelomatous deposit. This was her assessment at that point in time. The lambda was 74.2 with a kappa of 10.5 and a ratio of 0.142. The PET at that point in time also revealed metabolically active lytic lesions involving multiple bones, as enlisted here, and an extraosseous soft tissue lesion also in the petrous apex. She presented with severe pain and thereby also underwent some local RT at that point in time. So in this situation, in this particular patient, the way she's presented and had these treatments, what would your thoughts be on the subsequent treatment and management of this patient, Dr. Akanksha? A background of limited finances also here.
Okay, sir. So, definitely this patient at the beginning itself, she was a high-risk myeloma case. So, she was treated with 6 cycles of VTD. Initially, only if finances would have permitted, she should have been given something like a KRD regimen and then taken up as early as possible for a transplant. But obviously, she didn't undergo a transplant, and she again relapsed shortly in September 2018, when she was started with KPD regimen and she received 4 cycles. At that time also, I think she has received radiation to the lower back region. And following this again, she was only in PR. Her cytogenetics were again complex in nature. So she underwent an autologous transplant. Now, presently, I think she has relapsed within 1 year of her transplant. And she has now got extensive extramedullary disease, where there is increased deposition in the infratemporal fossa, as well as there is an extraosseous soft tissue lesion in the left petrous apex. So again, this is an extramedullary relapse in the CNS. So for this particular patient, this is again a very aggressive kind of disease, given the background of already a high-risk myeloma initially itself. So for me, she has limited finances because this is extensive extramedullary disease. I would like to do a chemo reduction with the help of chemotherapy in the form of maybe a DT pace regimen if her performance status permits. If she has a low performance status, then probably I could also consider giving a DSEP regimen. And as we know that such cases of extramedullary disease, they need to be given early cytoreduction. So that would be my choice for her. And I would basically evaluate her after 2 cycles of therapy and then decide her further therapy. Also, because she has received already RT twice, I think there is probably some scope of giving radiotherapy to the petrous lesion. So for that, I would also like to take opinion from the radiation oncology side. So that's how I would go for a DT-based regimen or a DSET for this particular patient.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Yeah.
Can I add something?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please. We were waiting for your input.
DT-based is deadly stuff. Okay.
Yes.
So
yes.
If you have limited finances, please don't do DT-based for a person. It is really very toxic. So I would say if your finances are limited, you have bad disease, you've got hypodiploidy, I think you should palliate at this stage because you've given whatever is reasonable for this patient so far.
Yeah, I agree, sir. DTPase is not easy to do. And just to continue where Dr. Akanksha left off, this patient did receive radiation to that petrous lesion. And then, you know, on limited finances, under whatever the scheme, the Arogya scheme, what is available, she was only eligible to get CVAD. And she actually responded to 6 cycles of CVAD, to tell you. That was the follow-up on this particular patient. But as expected, within another next 3-4 months, she relapsed again. So she definitely needed more intensive therapy. But it's not easy to give DTPase in our setting, especially if there's limited finances. So now she's kind of reached a stage where she's going to kind of go into a palliative phase. So that is what actually happened. So I'm in a subset of patients, I think a little bit of a CVAD-like therapy works for some time. And then again, you will progress if it's aggressive disease. So that's what actually happened. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I would not give the vincristine. I certainly would agree with your giving cyclophosphamide, Adriamycin, dexamethasone. The VCR only adds to toxicity. So probably avoid the vincristine.
Okay. Right, sir. Thank you, Dr. Akansha. We will now move on to the next case. This is a 51-year-old male, and this is to Dr. Kishore Kumar. So this is a patient who was basically evaluated by the nephrologist, presented to their department for evaluation of nausea, vomiting, features of uremia, came in a creatinine of 8.5, potassium of 6, AG reversal, and then got evaluated on that background. They found an M spike of 4.2 grams, kappa lambda ratio of 42 with 36% plasma cells in the marrow. Incidentally, no lytic lesions, predominantly with the renal presentation. We started on VCD, three cycles, post which he went into a partial remission. Creatinine still sitting up at 6.9 with weekly twice dialysis going on. So some financial constraints, obviously, that's the reason why Dara wasn't looked at upfront here. But this is the common scenario we do see in our setting. So this is how this patient has come. And typically, like, we do get a referral where patient goes to nephrology and then gets a consult. And we come in and have to plan his treatment. So Kishore, your thoughts on initial management of this patient? Subsequently, how will you manage with that creatinine sitting like that, dialysis? Were your thoughts on auto? And then this kind of patient will invariably ask you about the renal transplant because somebody would have brought that up. Yes. So your thoughts on all these in this particular case?
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the question. So it really put me into a different scenario where I have to deal with another set of different specialty people with a fixed idea. So it's like it's a nightmare to do. But anyway, this is, as you said, sir, somehow you know my OP patients, I suppose. There are three patients right now who are in the same, nearly the same situation. So whatever has been done till now is really great, sir. One thing I'm not sure, mostly in our setting, when the patient goes up to the nephrologist before initiating dialysis, they kind of insist on getting a renal biopsy. I mean, many times it's that the biopsy that is being done because they don't worry much about the AG reversal and all. And the cast morphology or something comes up on the biopsy, and then they retrospectively look into the diagnosis of myeloma. Because with the renal disease, yes, it's quite, at least a quarter of our patients do have some degree of renal disease. But with the extensive renal disease, many times you are really enthusiastic, because whenever I counsel my patient, the first thing I say is, I have to start on a bortezomib or whatever the proteasome inhibitor which is going to work for you, thinking that I'm going to get you out of a dialysis. That is quite a morbidity for the patient. Many times this is like a successful operation, but the patient dead. So we would have kind of reduced the myeloma to a great extent, but unfortunately the dialysis, that's the reason why he ultimately ended up to the hospital. So in such situation, the things immediately that comes into my mind is, again, VCD, CyBorD has been an age-old protocol where we have been using it in patients who have really bad renal problems. But if you theoretically ask me, sir, yes, there are studies, pharmacokinetic studies, where they have looked into carfilzomib-based regimens also, and they have proven that it is very much possible. And in this case, you are told about a cost constraint, though most of the the data on daratumumab is all the studies, basically they were taking up patients who are having a creatinine clearance of more than 20. But there are a lot of anecdotal reports. Even Dr. Rahul has published two case reports where he has very much successfully used daratumumab in such a setting to get a patient into some kind of a decent renal response. But the ultimate aim here is there are two ways of looking at it. First thing is a transplant eligible guy. So my aim will be to get into, that's what my job is to get the myeloma as much as possible into a deeper control. And there are studies to very well prove that, yes, if I get a myeloma into the deeper control, there are at least a quarter of patients, or even up to, there are a few Spanish studies, even CABMT data says, with the deeper remission, at least one third of patients may even become dialysis independent. So I should be kind of proceeding with that in my mind, so that let the patient be on dialysis. So dialysis is one savior for me, because I am kind of free to use most of the drugs in proper doses, probably, provided I have to kind of space it right with my kidney people. So I think only three cycles of VCD, that is quite early somehow. So if finances are really issues, sometimes even I may think of considering, the one alternative I may think of is to change to an IMID kind of a thing, which can be added here, if at all, I think a small low cost change, which I can make with thalidomide or lenalidomide at a dose, renal dose adjustment, which is quite a controversial area. Again, there are many studies how to renal adjust a lenalidomide dose. But I may even go ahead with one or two more cycles, get some more decent response. And with the background, if I achieve a VGPR or something, better to get on with the transplant. So in the background of dialysis itself, just I want to space my medications and transplant everything in liaison with the renal people, that's all. Because CABMTR data says that transplant, post-transplant, the people going for dialysis independency is also up to 20 to 25%. So my aim will be to proceed to achieve a deeper response in this case. So if finances are not an issue, yes, there are a lot of options which you have already listed here. If finances are going to be issue, still not an problem, you can go ahead with few more cycles. Many times it's 4 to 6 cycles is what we sometimes we encounter before achieving a deeper response. A VGPR, take up for an autograft and then do kind of a maintenance. It may be even a bortezomib based maintenance. So that's what I may plan, provided things are going according to my plan. And if you really ask me about the renal transplant, first thing, bone marrow transplant is many people have that fixed idea that it's something to take a higher risk if there is a dialysis dependent patient. In our 117 patients in our transplant number over the last 7 years, there are 4 transplants whom we have done with the patient being on dialysis, but it depends upon an extensive counseling and also a liaison with the renal department. But post thing, if you ask me, well, theoretically speaking, all the Western data says a 5 years disease in remission, I can even consider the patient to be taken up for a renal transplant. But somehow I have never been successful in doing that. And in Tamil Nadu, you know that if I want to list the patient for a transplant, transturn is what we call the general list of bone renal transplants or organ transplants. Malignancy comes as the first negative mark so that they don't even allow us to put them on a list for a cadaver transplant. So this we have talked, but that seems quite theoretical for me. I have not done it. Maybe somebody else, maybe here in the panel, who would have tried a renal transplant after 3 to 5 years of a good remission. But I think, sir, this patient, even I can give few more cycles or change over to some drugs. Finances are not an issue. I can very well use all these drugs. They are relatively, not only they are renally safe, and with the dialysis backup, I think with an aim to achieve a deeper myeloma response, I should aim towards a transplant in this guy, for an autograft, somehow achieving a deeper response.
Thanks, Kishore. I think I've got one patient who managed to cross that 5-year remission hurdle and get a renal transplant done. He's kind of doing well. So that's a good thought which you came up with. If Dr. Maman is there, sir, your thoughts, sir, on this issue of renal transplant in patients with myeloma?
I think the data suggests that if you have got control over the myeloma, you can take the patient for a renal transplant, and that your longevity would be dependent on how well your myeloma remains controlled. So it's not a contraindication.
Right, sir. Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Right. Thank you, Kishore. We'll go on to the next case. Case number 6. This is to Dr. Tufan Dolai. So Dr. Tufan, this is a 64-year-old lady diagnosed with IgG kappa myeloma with lytic lesions, anemia at initial presentation. Initial M protein was 3.6 grams per DL. FISH demonstrates standard risk with deletion 13q. She was treated with frontline therapy with bortezomib len dex 4 cycles, followed by high-dose melphalan and autologous stem cell transplant. She was then started on maintenance len and achieved a CR. However, 34 months after her transplant, she has evidence of a new lytic lesion in her humerus on PET and reappearance of her M protein at 0.8 grams. So how would you like to approach this patient, Dr. Tufan?
Yes, yes. Thank you, Sarath. So this is basically the 64-year patient has been received the 4th cycle of the VRD followed by the transplant. Then subsequently on the lenalidomide maintenance, he relapsed. And basically he is on the standardies of the patient, I presume, that this patient has a severe bone pain. That's why the PET CT has been done. He's become symptomatic. That's right. Why we are planning for the treatment of these patients.
Right.
As the patient on the VRD, this is the one of the most effective regimen for the treatment of the myeloma. And on len, he have been relapsed. Even in the standard risk, I think the options are the monoclonal antibody-based therapy. The first line monoclonal antibody-based therapy will be the better options. As patients have been already received the bortezomib-based regimen, so daratumumab, pomalidomide, dexa can be the good option. Then second will be the daratumumab, bortezomib, dexa will be the another option. But in my center, We are using the carfilzomib pomalidomide dexa as a trial protocol. We are doing a trial on the carfilzomib pomalidomide dexa in the each and every patient of the first relapse, whether in the standardization, the high risks. So in my center, I am using the carfilzomib pomalidomide dexa. But theoretically, as the VRD, the significant, the best regimen, one of the best regimen in the first relapse, the monoclonal antibody regimen will be the better option. We are not preferring the four drug regimen.
Right, Dr. Tufan, with the issue of affordability, you know, coming in.
Sharad.
Yes.
So there is a one trial coming up with the bispecific antibodies against BCMA. So someone who is exposed to the pomalidomide will not be eligible for the trial. So this is going to be an exciting trial, which will be running in April or June next year.
Okay.
With the pomalid naive patients. I just wanted to say we may have some trials with the bispecific antibodies.
So prior exposure to pomalidomide is an exclusion, Dinesh?
Exclusion criteria, correct.
Okay. So that's something to consider when people are going on to the second line. So Dr. Tufan, your current trial, which has been recruiting patients, what is the response rate so far? Or if you have any data to tell us about how things are going with that, where you're doing this in all the relapse patients?
Basically, this is the trial protocol. I cannot confirm in the...
Okay. So you're just... Yeah, fine. So they're going on to this arm.
Yes,
right. Okay. And so this is patients who relapse even post autologous transplant, or irrespective of that, you would take them on to this?
Right. You are doing the carfilzomib pomalidomide dexa.
Right. Okay. Thank you so much. I think either of those regimens, clearly you're trying to say that patient is refractory to len here. So that's something which you would take off and replace with another drug. And you have various combinations which can be used here, which is left to, I think, individual, and it may be patient-based, based even on finances. And based on that, you would take a call on changing your regimen and then trying to achieve a kind of response and then continuing maintenance in that setting. That's what we would kind of write home on this particular case when you're talking about len refractiveness. And that's what is suggested on the study which is published in the Lancet Journal and from the International Working Group of Myeloma. Right. So we'll come to case number 7, and this is to Dr. Neeraj Siddharthan. So Neeraj, this is a 76-year-old man diagnosed with kappa light chain myeloma with anemia on presentation. Myeloma fish again demonstrated standard risk disease. He underwent induction with bortezomib Lendex for 8 cycles and achieved a CR. And after that, due to personal preference, he stopped myeloma therapy and just elected observation. I mean, this is sometimes a common scenario in our country also, where people stop medication either due to finances or whatever reason. 15 months later, he developed asymptomatic biochemical relapse of disease that was initially observed, but now with an acceleration, progression with serum free kappa light chain level of 330 and a free light chain ratio of 44.2. A repeat bone marrow biopsy showed no high risk FISH markers. They were all negative. So how would you approach this particular patient, Neeraj?
Thank you, sir. I think this is a very commonly encountered scenario.
Right.
In particularly, this patient has received properly an appropriate induction therapy, but somehow I think it would have been better if he was willing for a maintenance with lenalidomide being a standard risk disease. Now, this relapse seems to be indolent so far because he is asymptomatic, number one, and number two, that the repeat bone marrow biopsy also has not shown any high-risk features, including the FISH markers. But at the same time, at this point of relapse, we do not know, whether this will turn into an aggressive sooner. But in any case, I think here I would choose treating this patient rather than not treating this patient. But one consideration would be that the patient is a 76-year-old outpatient, asymptomatic. And so I would consider probably starting him on lenalidomide and dexamethasone, probably because he's completely asymptomatic, and wait on him very closely, observing his parameters. Now, if the relapse is aggressive, it should declare itself. But before that, I think it will be very difficult to convince him to go for anything more intensive, including injectable therapies like carpal zoming.
Right. Thanks, Neeraj. So you would tend to think that you would initiate some kind of therapy, not too aggressive. Is Dr. Maman there? Sir, your thoughts, sir, yes. When you start getting biochemical relapse in somebody who's asymptomatic, but there are two sets of patients, one who want to get treated because of that fear, and second, whether the physician takes a call and waiting on it.
It's tough, Sharad. Biochemical relapses, if the patient absolutely refuses to have treatment, I can wait on them. And when there's progression start,
right, sir.
I agree with that approach. And here, I sort of agree with Neeraj, because the patient is asymptomatic. He's 76 years old, and he's had a 15-month hiatus of drugs. So he might still be sensitive to lenalidomide index, and right. That will keep him comfortable for quite some time. So I would agree with what Neeraj is suggesting, and that if it was symptomatic, whether to add the bortezomib, again, because of its low cost, and because this particular patient had a 15-month gap, he still might be sensitive to bortezomib and may not have developed mutations which require Kyprolis or carfilzomib. I want to ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
Would you agree that for standard risk and intermediate risk, newly diagnosed multiple myeloma,
yes,
the
sir.
Endurance trial and the Clarion trial
yes,
do
sir.
Not show in randomized setting a benefit of carfilzomib over bortezomib?
Right. Yes. So
I should address that to Dr. Agarwal.
Yes, sir. Dr. Agarwal's thoughts, sir.
Absolutely. I mean, in standard risk multiple myeloma, it is now very clear that carfilzomib has no advantage over bortezomib, and it is even more toxic. Not only
right.
No advantage, even more toxic, more adverse events. So this data was presented by Shaji 1.5 years ago, and it is now published.
Right. Yeah. So clearly in the standard risk, I think there's no data
absolutely.
To say. Yeah, absolutely. Right.
My comment to Dr. Was regarding high-risk patients were not included in that trial.
Correct.
So only there was T440. There was no deletion 17P. There were no losses of 1Q. There were no other translocations. There was no 1P, nothing. So only 414 was included, and that we know that Velcade works in 414.
Dr. Agarwal, since you asked the question, can I ask you, is there a cutoff for the percentage? And do you do for 17P, and do you do a mutation for P53 in all patients? For CLL, I am now doing both a FISH as well as a mutation analysis, because a small proportion of patients who are biallelic have a 17P and a mutation, or both mutations without any 17P. Is that the case for myeloma?
So you're quite right that for CLL now there is a standard package which includes TP53 mutation, and there are patients who are not deletion 17P and still are TP53 mutated. But when it comes to myeloma, once again, you're absolutely right that looking at TP53, I was quite surprised that Sharath's patient, multiple of them had TP53 study, but that's not something which is routinely done. Most of the people will stop at the level of FISH only. Karyotyping is available in majority of the centers. It may be karyotyping with FISH, but one does not really routinely practice go to TP53. About your question of cutoff, in the research trials, TP53 has been biallelic 20%.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you, sirs. We'll go on to our second last case. I think this time we can do one more. So this is to Dr. Upendra Sharma. Dr. Upendra, this is a 55-year-old man diagnosed with IgG kappa myeloma with lytic bone lesions on presentation. FISH demonstrated 1114 and amplification of 1Q21 with 4 copies of the CKS1B. He was treated with bortezomib len dex for 3 cycles, followed by high dose melphalan and ASCT, followed by maintenance bortezomib len dex, given his high risk in this particular approach. His best response was an MRD negative CR. After 29 months on maintenance therapy, he had disease progression, at which time he was treated with second-line dara-pom-dex. After 15 months of dara-pom-dex, the patient now again has evidence of disease progression. So, Dr. Upendra, how will you approach this patient and what would you recommend?
So, sir, this is patient, sir, can you go to previous slide? 55-year male. We have a fish showing 11-14, that is standard risk, but we have an amplification of 1Q.
Right.
There's 4 copies, that is significant. Just Dr. Agarwal has elaborated his slides that those patients who are having more than four copies, it is significant, high risk, and if it's less than four, then it is including in the standard risk. So this patient had 4 copies of CKS1B, so it is high risk myeloma. So he received bortezomib, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone, 3 cycles, transplant, and followed by maintenance because of high risk with the triplet. So today's presentation, Dr. Agarwal's presentation, and we have seen in the 40 trial, the results of giving high-risk myeloma patients, carfilzomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, followed by 4 cycles, then transplantation, and then consolidation with 4 cycles of carfilzomib, lenalidomide, dexamethasone, and then maintenance with carfilzomib and lenalidomide. But for most of our patients, with those cost constraints, we end up using lenalidomide and dexamethasone as induction for those patient transplantation, and then some sort of, maintenance for subset of patients. So now this patient has relapsed after lenalidomide and transplantation. So received daratumumab, pomalidomide, dexamethasone, and has now having disease progression post 15 months of dara-pom-dex. So now this patient has not received carfilzomib yet. So his carfilzomib naive. So we can include any regime which includes carfilzomib. This patient can receive carfilzomib, cyclophosphamide, dexamethasone. So this combination has not been used till now for this patient. So this is a good combination which can be used for this patient. As such, in venetoclax, presently not available in our country, but seeing this patient having 11-14 translocation. So venetoclax can be an option for such subset of patient. So venetoclax, bortezomib, dexamethasone can be an option for this patient. I will not be happy to use DTPase now for this patient because we have option of carfilzomib. It's carfilzomib. So carfilzomib, a preferred regime for this patient. If patient further relapses on these regimes, then CAR T cell therapy because he had received proteasome inhibitor, monoclonal antibody, and immunomodulatory agencies. Once he has restricted to these, then those patients can be candidate for CAR T cell therapy or belantamab can be option for those patients.
Yeah, thank you, Upendra. I think certainly that option of venetoclax is something which can come up here in this setting. You still have another MAB which you can look at and considering that he's high risk and he progresses, and if there's the availability of CAR T, then certainly that's something which can come up for discussion down the line, I presume, now that various centers are looking at potentially utilizing, and setting up CAR T. If Dr. Maman is around, sir, your thoughts on CAR T coming into India, sir, particularly for myeloma, just the BCMA?
Sharad, I think it has to come, it will come, and the readies are already working on it. He's set a date of 2024. I think there will be other groups also who are working on CAR T. At TMC, we are working on a CD19 CAR. We are planning to use a construct which is already tried, and that's what we want to do. I think CMC Vellore also is doing the same thing. But, I have a feeling that the bispecific antibodies, the T-cell engaging antibodies, may in fact be good and may be as good as CAR T without too much of the cost, they will have the same problems of the CRS as well as neurological toxicity. But I think the bispecific T cell engagers for myeloma against BCMA are going to compete with CAR T as agents in relapse refractory. With regard to elotuzumab, we have used it only in one patient who failed daratumumab, and he also failed elotuzumab, though the data suggests that about 20% of patients who failed daratumumab can respond to elotuzumab. But we had singularly no response with elotuzumab when we had already used daratumumab, and there was a failure with daratumumab.
So is that also a similar situation as far as belantamab also goes, sir?
See, this belantamab has horrible keratitis eye toxicity. 30 to 40% of patients develop a very bad keratitis. So in fact, belantamab as an agent is now coming into a bit of disrepute, and people are not happy to use the belantamab mafodotin.
Right, right.
I and think venetoclax would be the agent to use, because the data on the 1114 is really good, and you might get a reasonably good response combining venetoclax with some of the other agents. And it's available ad nauseum in the gray market.
Comes
via Bangladesh, I believe. But we have used it for many patients with MDS, and we use it along with voriconazole so that we keep it at 100 milligrams rather than having to go up to 400 milligrams.
Right. And so your thoughts on the previous case, I actually brought up this question specifically to you, on the thoughts of allotransplant in myeloma, specifically both sibling and haplo, and the potential conditioning regimens to look at.
Sharad, I still believe that allogeneic transplant is a clinical trial, and it is not standard of care. And most people all over the world would accept that an allotransplant, for some reason, toxicity is higher, and two, relapse despite a transplant. I've had patients who sailed through the transplant within 6 months, myeloma is back. We had a young lady, a nurse, whom we took for an allotransplant. Within 3 months of transplant, the myeloma was back. And even in high-risk situations like myeloma, plasma cell leukemia, allo doesn't seem to be the answer. So I think CAR-T or a bispecific would trump over an allo in terms of toxicity. Saying even in young patients, which I have done, relapse is very high and transplant-related toxicity is high. So I would say allo remains in the domain of a clinical trial. It is not standard treatment.
Right. Thank you, sir. So I think I'll close on this. We've finished all the cases for each of the discussants, and we've had inputs from both Dr. Maman and Dr. Agarwal. I'd like to end the case discussion here. Thank you for participating actively in the discussion. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Sharad, for that wonderful, great cases and the panel who discussed each case so beautifully. I'll just sum up. The idea of today's webinar is to update you about all aspects of myeloma treatment, newly diagnosed and relapsed refractory. Also to discuss about exact placement of carfilzomib in the treatment of myeloma. It became very clear that in the relapse setting, there is hardly any question that you will be using carfilzomib, whether you have used bortezomib upfront or not, because there is no cross resistance and the drug is manifold cheaper than daratumumab. So that carfilzomib combined with one of the IMiD that has not been used upfront becomes the standard of care for the first line of treatment after relapses. It was also very clear today that if you have a high-risk myeloma, which accounts for 20% of patients and which you must look for, you need to do something beyond VRD, not only in the induction, also in the intensification, and probably the maintenance treatment has to be individualized. So here comes the role of giving two drugs and again carfilzomib, scorzomib, in this particular setup. So high-risk patients have to be treated in a very different way upfront. There is a British trial now going on for high-risk patients where 5-drug induction has been used. The trial has just began 6 to 8 months ago, so no one knows the outcome of these kind of trials, followed by tandem transplant, 3-drug maintenance, etc. So this is an unmet need totally. What to do about the high-risk myeloma patient, whether they are genetically defined or whether they are extramedullary disease, whether these are plasma cell leukemia, one is not very clear exactly because there is no major breakthrough. Sooner or later, bispecifics and CAR-T will keep moving upfront, 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 and a day will come when these drugs will probably be some kind of solution to high-risk myeloma patients when they come in the first line of treatment. As was pointed out, I think allo transplant has been of historical importance now. There will not be any research on allo transplant in the days of bispecifics and CAR-T, which is really the future of myeloma treatment. So with that, I hand over the dais now to Abhishek to give the official vote of thanks.
Thank you very much, sir. I think I don't have anything much to say. Apart from that, I personally really enjoyed the entire session and must thank everyone, all the faculties for being there for the program. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Have a good night.
Thank you for supporting this. Thank you. And thanks to everybody.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Good night.